The Serpent and the Illuminati. By Sherry Schreiner. For the past 2,000 years, the signs and artifacts of a pre-Adamic civilization have haunted the churches. Controlled by Rome, who rules them all, they were and have been steered away from seeking answers. While many follow church dogma in blind acceptance, many more know something is missing and seek answers on their own. Many are starting to step out of the box of mind control and seek Yahuwah and his truths on their own. Over the centuries, archaeologists have found artifacts and signs of a pre-Adamic civilization indicating extreme intelligent life had once existed before ours and predated well before the flood of Noah. So much so that our own modern technologically advanced world could not even begin to explain how a civilization before ours could have been so much more advanced than our own. The churches did not have the answers about this previous civilization, and those who did not want the information known, but kept hidden and tucked away into what eventually would become known as secret societies. Instead of serving as ministers of righteousness, those who control our churches became ministers of suppressing information. What are they hiding? Jesus told us the last days would be as the days of Noah. Most of those in the top hierarchy of the churches don't serve the Most High God, they serve Lucifer, and they suppress the early days of civilization from the people so that when it comes around again and presents itself in the last days, it can be utilized as part of the charade that heralds the Antichrist as God. They are all working together, the tops of the churches, governments, secret societies, passed on through the ages by positions. They are trying to deceive the people and keep them in the dark about the past so they won't recognize what is coming in the future, or what recognize the daily war we are in against the battle between the wheat and the tares. Most smaller churches don't realize they are controlled, or how much they are. Most pastors today have graduated from the seminaries of the dead that are owned and operated by such New Age charlatans as Norman Vincent Peale and Jesuits posing as Protestants sent by the Roman Catholic Church to infiltrate and control them. All of the religious organizations and denominational chains are steered at the top by henchmen who serve Rome. Independent churches form to break away from denominational chains, but through their years of training of doctrine conditioning, they never really break away from the box. Digging into the Bible codes, I discovered there was indeed a thriving technologically advanced civilization on Earth previously, and that because of their rebellion against the Most High, its civilization was obliterated out of existence, causing the complete destruction of the Earth. This civilization on Earth contained the ancient cities of Atlantis and Lemuria and had intergalactic trade with other planets such as Mars, Venus, and the others within our solar system. When Lucifer rebelled against the Most High as the reigning cherub over all these planets, he instigated a multi-planet rebellion, bringing the Lord's wrath of hailstones of fire against all the planets involved. Entire angelic civilizations were destroyed, and many of these angels involved that did not face his immediate judgment of imprisonment were forced into the hollow areas of their respective planets to survive. The Bible speaks of Lucifer's rebellion in Isaiah 14:12-14. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground which didst weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God, I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation, in the sides of the north, I will ascend above the heights of the clouds, I will be like the Most High. In Ezekiel 28 it says, You were the anointed cherub that covers, and I had put you in the holy height of God. Lucifer was not happy just being a high-ranking cherub with rule over several planets. He wanted to be like the Most High God. And you will find the pre-Adamic, prehistoric civilization on this earth within his realm of dominion and rebellion. Most of us are led to believe that Lucifer's rebellion was a quick event that was quickly put down by the Most High God, but it did not happen that way. The evolutionists were not completely wrong. These things did exist at one time, a concept the church refuses to even acknowledge. But where everyone has gone wrong is in who created what. Atlantis and Lemuria were cities on ancient Earth where these angels dwelled and developed technology that far surpassed anything we have ever had or seen. And they were not confined to Earth, they could travel to distant planets and visit, trade, and cohabitate with the angels who lived on them. In fact, The New World Order is nothing but this ancient planetary Old World Order revived for the last days. Planetary trade and economics was Lucifer's dominion, and he ruled from a distant planet called Rahab. The Bible codes reveal that Lucifer had a mansion or dwelling place on all these planets including Earth, but his home planet was Rahab, located between Mars and Jupiter, and it was completely destroyed and cast out of our solar system with its inhabitants imprisoned inside of it. Rahab is returning to Earth in these last days and is known more commonly as Nibiru or Planet X, where those imprisoned will be released and allowed to come to Earth to help Lucifer subdue and conquer it. When the Lord judged and destroyed Rahab, he allowed Lucifer and some of his forces to escape. The DNA imprint of humans is November 22, 33, and the angels couldn't duplicate it. It represents the 11 ribs, 22 bones in the skull, and the 33 vertebrae of mankind. To this day, these are the most significant numbers for any occult group in existence. They could not figure it out then, and to this day, they cannot master and duplicate Yahuwah's creation of man and woman. After the Most High had had enough of their rebellion, and having given them plenty of time to repent for doing so, he utterly destroyed their homes and civilizations. The planets were all destroyed with hailstones of fire, and those who rebelled were cast into imprisonment or forced to make homes in the inside hollow cavities of their respective planets to live in. As part of their judgment, they lost their angelic looks and appearance and became ugly, grotesque-looking beings. When the Most High recreated the Earth, many, perhaps thousands of years later, Lucifer and his minions watched. And they conspired to destroy the creation of man and woman that Yahuwah had placed in the Garden of Eden. Since the recreation of Earth and the creation of Adam and Eve, Lucifer has worked behind the scenes directly and indirectly conspiring and working to destroy the Most High's plans. And since Lucifer's initial rebellion, the Lord has allowed it and used Lucifer for his own purposes through it all. Isa 45:7 I form the light, and create darkness, I make peace, and create evil, I the Lord do all these things. It wasn't long after God had created Adam and Eve that Satan would make his move on how to destroy what Yahuwah had created. Lucifer, one of the trees of the garden they were commanded to stay away from, seduced Eve, and through the child of their union, Cain, the serpent seed line of the devils would begin. Cain, the serpent's seed. In Genesis 3:15 he said, "And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed." Enmity means mutual hatred. He is saying there is mutual hatred between the seed line of Satan's and the seed line of Eve's. So there are two seed lines. The serpent seed started with Cain and Adam's seed started with Seth. No matter how they have tried to cover it up in the KJV, the Dead Sea Scrolls and even verses such as General 3:15 make it clear that Satan had his own seed line and it started back with Eve. Let's start at the beginning of Genesis chapter 3. Genesis 3:1-6. 1. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, "Yea, hath God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden?" In the Hebrew, the word serpent is Hebrew word number 5175, nakash, nakash, a snake, from its hiss. From number 5172, nakash, nakash, a primitive root, properly, to hiss, i.e., whisper, a magic, spell, generally, to prognosticate, to practice divination, to divine, to observe signs, to learn by experience, to diligently observe, to practice fortune telling, to take as an omen. This obviously is describing a person, and not a literal reptile. This serpent is no ordinary snake. It is Satan himself. The serpent is just one of Satan's many names. In the book of Revelation there are several of Satan's names identified, but it is all the same one entity, such as serpent, devil, or dragon. The word tree is Hebrew word number 6086, ets, ets, a tree, from its firmness, from number 6095 atza, atza, a primitive root, properly, to fasten, or make firm, i.e., to close the eyes. Figuratively, the spine giving firmness to the body is the trunk, and the arms and legs are the limbs. And God uses the word tree symbolically in the scriptures to mean people both good and bad. And below is just one example of trees being used symbolically for people. Isaiah 61:1-3. 1 The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek, he hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound. 2 To proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord, and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all that mourn. 3 To appoint unto them that mourn in Zion, to give unto them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they might be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he might be glorified. KJV. Back to Genesis. 2 And the woman said unto the serpent, We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden. 3 But of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, Ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. The phrase fruit of the tree is Hebrew word number 6529 peri fruit, in a wide sense, a. fruit, produce, of the ground, or b. fruit, offspring, children, progeny, used of the womb, or figuratively c. fruit, of actions. The phrase eat of it is Hebrew word number 398, akal, akal. This word has many uses, among which, one use means to lay with a woman, which is a sexual act, touch is Hebrew word number 5060, naga, naga, properly, to touch, i.e., to lay the hand upon, for any purpose, euphemism for, to lie with a woman. 4 And the serpent said unto the woman, Ye shall not surely die. The word serpent is Satan. The phrase ye shall not surely die is the first lie in the Bible, and it was Satan as the serpent that uttered it. Satan is called the father of lies. 5 For God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. The phrase your eyes shall be opened is the second lie in the Bible, and Satan is also the author of this one. Remember from verse 1, that the tree that the serpent wants Eve to partake of means, to close the eyes, as in being deceived, and losing sight of the only commandment from God at that time. Remember God said to Adam in Gen 2:17, But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof thou shalt surely die. Anyway on to verse 3:6. 6 And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. This was obviously no ordinary tree, in fact it wasn't a literal tree at all, it was Satan himself. The phrase pleasant to the eyes equals Hebrew word number 2530, chamad, to desire, to covet, to take pleasure in, to be desirable, to delight greatly, to desire greatly, desirableness, preciousness. The word desired equals Hebrew word number 8378 tayava, tayavia, from 183, abbreviated, to yearn for, to lust after, used of bodily appetites, a longing, by implication, a delight, subjectively, satisfaction, objectively, a charm, a desire, a wish, longings of one's heart, lust, an appetite, covetousness, in a bad sense, to covet, to wait longingly. To make one wise equals apple trees don't make you smart, but Satan can give you forbidden knowledge. The word took equals Hebrew word number 3947 lakak, lakak, a primitive root, to take, in the widest variety of applications to take, to lay hold of, to receive, to marry, to take a wife, to take to or for a person, to procure, to get, to take possession of, to select, to choose, to take in marriage, to receive, to accept. This sure doesn't sound like Eve is just enjoying an apple, this is far more than an appreciation for literal fruit on a literal tree. All of this language is figurative and symbolic for what really happened. Does the account above sound like someone eating an apple to you? Of course not, but you have probably been lied to since Sunday school about what really happened in the Garden of Eden. Here is what really happened in the Garden of Eden. Eve lost her virginity to the serpent, whom was that tree of the knowledge of good and evil in the midst of the garden, and who is none other than Satan himself. By the way, I haven't seen the word apple mentioned in these scriptures yet, have you? You won't either. Nowhere in God's word does it say that Adam and Eve ate an apple. Yet we see modern religious paintings showing Eve holding an apple. Why? Because it makes for good symbolism and makes a better story to hide what really happened. Adam also partook of this forbidden fruit. Satan is a supernatural being possessing supernatural powers, thus he can appear to Adam and Eve as two different things, beings, entities, if he had wanted to. We don't know for sure as to what degree Adam partook of this fruit, but as we read on, we will see that Eve became pregnant from her doing so. She was impregnated and conceived by the serpent first, then she conceived a second time from Adam. Eve went on to bear twins, Cain and Abel. Genesis 3:7-13. 7 And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together, and made themselves aprons. Eating apples doesn't make you ashamed of your nakedness. But losing your innocence and your virginity certainly can. We also notice that they didn't make masks to cover mouths that had just eaten apples, they made aprons to cover their private parts because they were now more conscious of them and embarrassed. Simply eating an apple does not do this to anyone. Fruit does not make one aware or conscious of whether they have clothes on or not. 8 And they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God amongst the trees of the garden. 9 And the Lord God called unto Adam, and said unto him, Where art thou? 10 And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, and I hid myself. 11 And he said, Who told thee that thou wast naked? Hast thou eaten of the tree, whereof I commanded thee that thou shouldest not eat? 12 And the man said, The woman whom thou gavest to be with me, she gave me of the tree, and I did eat. 13 And the Lord God said unto the woman, What is this that thou hast done? And the woman said, The serpent beguiled won me, and I did eat. KJV. In Strong's, number 398, the term eat means to eat, also to lay. The term touch in Strong's is number 5060, which means naga, to touch, also to have sexual intercourse. Both terms had and have sexual connotations to them. Beguiled used in this text is the same as seduced. Furthermore, scripture says Cain was of that wicked one, he was a son of Satan's through the seduction of Eve. The term of is the same that means offspring. Neither is Cain listed anywhere in the descendants of Adam, which strongly indicates Cain was not his son. The official beginning of the wheat and the tares began with Eve. The wheat and the tares. The tree of knowledge was the means to sexual knowledge they received from Lucifer. Knowledge is to know. Knowing means to perceive, experience, learn. It is also used as an euphemism of to know someone sexually, as when Adam knew his wife. The terms eat, touch, and know are often used in biblical lingo for sexual relations. Lucifer was the way of knowing good and evil. He was the tree of the knowledge of good and evil because through him they would learn evil, they would perceive evil, and they would experience it. Who was the tree of life in the Garden of Eden? Yahushuah was. Who was the tree of the knowledge of good and evil? Lucifer. How do we eat of the tree of life? We commune with him. We are never to commune with Lucifer, and in this instance he seduced Eve, impregnated her, and began his own genealogical offspring and seed line on this earth that is part of us today. Gen 3:14-15. 14 And the Lord God said unto the serpent, Because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle, and above every beast of the field, upon thy belly shalt thou go, and dust shalt thou eat all the days of thy life. The phrase upon thy belly shalt thou go is a Hebraic, figure of speech, for utter defeat as in PS 72:9 and ISA 49:23. The phrase "dust shalt thou eat" equals a Hebraism, figure of speech, meaning an ultimate term of degradation, as in PS 44:25. Now the next verse will also show us the first mention of the promise of the Messiah Jesus Christ. This verse also contains the first prophecy in the Bible. 15 And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed; it shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. The word enmity is from the Hebrew word number 342 iba, from 340, hostility, a primitive root, to hate, as one of an opposite tribe or party, hence to be hostile. The phrase "between thee and the woman" equals not enmity between a garden snake and a woman, that doesn't even make sense. But enmity between the offspring of the serpent, Satan, and the offspring of the woman, Eve, through Adam, and thus of God. Between thy seed and her seed equals seed, Hebrew word number 2233 zera, seed, sowing, offspring, a sowing, seed, semen viral, offspring, descendants, posterity, children. From number 2232 to become pregnant, to be made pregnant. The word "it" refers to Jesus Christ. The phrase "bruise thy head" means Jesus destroying Satan. The word "thou" equals Satan, and "bruise his heel" equals Satan causing the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. Jesus' heels were bruised when he was nailed to the cross. The offspring and descendants of the serpent, Satan, are called Cainites, which means sons of Cain, whom was the first murderer. These Cainites multiplied, and in the process of time 4,000 years later, went on to infiltrate the Hebrew peoples and distort the Hebrew religion of the Old Testament, founding the religion of Judaism. It must be pointed out that all Hebrew peoples are not Jews. The term Jew is a religious moniker, not a national identity as alleged. Cain and Abel were what is called fraternal twins, which is one birth of two children, conceived at different times. Cain was born first, then Abel. Satan knew that the Messiah Jesus Christ would come through the lineage of Eve. This was the first attempt by Satan to destroy the pure seed line that Christ was to come through. Satan is fearful of Christ because he knows that it is Yahushuah, Jesus Christ, who will eventually accomplish casting him into the lake of fire, hell, which will be his eternal punishment. We know that Satan's plan failed with the ultimate birth of Yahushuah Jesus Christ, who upon his crucifixion, defeated death, which is to say defeated Satan. Satan is death; it is one of his many names and roles he has played and will play in the Bible. Many of you are hearing this for the first time. Because if you have sat in church programming all of your lives, you haven't heard the truth, even though it is right there in the Bible. The apple was figurative for sexual relations, masked with the terminology Eve was beguiled by Satan, and until people accept it as the truth it is, they will stay blind to the real war going on today, which is between the serpent seed line and the rest of the human race. Most church pastors today will pull out Genesis 4:1, which reads, "And Adam knew Eve his wife, and she conceived, and bare Cain, and said, I have gotten a man from the Lord." There are many omissions and translation errors throughout the Bible. The Dead Sea Scrolls confirm that Genesis 4:1 was tampered with. In fact, the passage should read, "And Adam knew his wife Eve, who was pregnant by Samuel, Satan, and she conceived and bare Cain, and he was like the heavenly beings, and not like the earthly beings, and she said, I have gotten a man from the angel of the Lord." Now we know that anything of the Lord is confirmed elsewhere. If Cain was indeed Satan's son, we wouldn't have to count on just one passage to prove it. In fact, there are many. John 3:12, "Not as Cain, who was of that wicked one, and slew his half brother." Here the word "of" in Greek is number 1537 in the Strong's Concordance. When used implying a person, it means a son of or offspring. Compare this with other translations. The New Testament in modern English, "We are none of us to have the spirit of Cain, who was a son of the devil." Living Bible, "We are not to be like Cain, who belonged to Satan." New English Bible, unlike Cain, who was a child of the evil one. New Century Bible, do not be like Cain, who belonged to the evil one. New Jerusalem Bible, not to be like Cain, who was from the evil one. And the popular commentaries confirm the same thing. The Wycliffe Bible Commentary, page 1473, he, Cain, is said to have belonged to the family of the wicked one. Matthew Poole's Commentary on the Holy Bible, volume 3, page 936. Which showed him, Cain, to be of that wicked one, of the serpent's seed, so early was such seed sown, and so ancient the enmity between seed and seed. Matthew Henry's Commentary, volume 6, page 1077, it showed that he, Cain, was as the firstborn of the serpent's seed. In John 8:44, Jesus was speaking to the Pharisees and proclaimed, "Ye are of your father the devil." The term of meaning generation, offspring. They were of the physical seed of their father the devil. Trees are often used as metaphors in regards to people. Jesus was the tree of life. We also find Matt 3:10, "And now also the axe is laid unto the root of the trees, therefore every tree which bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down, and cast into the fire." Matt 7:17, "Even so every good tree bringeth forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree bringeth forth evil fruit." Matt 7:18, "A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit." Matt 7:19, "Every tree that bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down, and cast into the fire." Matt 12:33, "Either make the tree good, and his fruit good, or else make the tree corrupt, and his fruit corrupt, for the tree is known by his fruit." Before Adam even had a chance to consummate his relationship with Eve, she was already pregnant with Lucifer's child, Cain. And that is what the Illuminati bloodlines of the New World Order don't want you to know. They are Cain's seed, of the wicked one. And it is this bloodline of Cain that is working together through the control of vast wealth around the world that is bringing the Antichrist to power. The parable of the wheat and tares. The parable of the wheat and tares is found in Matthew 13:24-30 and 37-43. Sandwiched in between in verse 35 is the proclamation, "I will utter things which have been kept secret from the foundation of the world." Jesus then revealed the significance of the parable as meaning he, Yahuwah, had fathered the good seed, wheat, and that the tares belonged to the wicked one, they had been fathered by Satan. Verses 24-30. The kingdom of heaven is likened unto a man which sowed good seed in his field. But while men slept, his enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. But when the blade was sprung up, and brought forth fruit, then appeared the tares also. So the servants of the householder came and said unto him, "Sir, didst not thou sow good seed in thy field? From whence then hath it tares?" He said unto them, "An enemy hath done this." The servants said unto him, "Wilt thou then that we go and gather them up?" But he said, "Nay, lest while ye gather up the tares, ye root up also the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest, and in the time of harvest I will say to the reapers, Gather ye together first the tares, and bind them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into my barn." In verses 38-43, Jesus gives us the meaning of the parable. He answered and said unto them, "He that soweth the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, the good seed are the children of the kingdom, but the tares are the children of the wicked one. The enemy that sowed them is the devil, the harvest is the end of the world, and the reapers are the angels. As therefore the tares are gathered and burned in the fire, so shall it be in the end of this world. The Son of Man shall send forth his angels, and they shall gather out of his kingdom all things that offend, and them which do iniquity. And shall cast them into a furnace of fire, there shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth. Then shall the righteous shine forth as the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Who hath ears to hear, let him hear." There were several declarations made in this parable that the churches often ignore. 1. The good seed were fathered by the Son of Man, Son of Adam. 2. The good seed, Adamites, are the genetic sons of Yahuwah. 3. the tares, Cain's seed, are the genetic sons of Satan. 4. The enemy that fathered the tares is the same serpent of Genesis 3:15. 5. The sons of Adam, wheat, will then inherit the kingdom after the tares, sons of Cain, are destroyed. Again, as stated in verse 38, the field is the world, the good seed are the children of the kingdom, but the tares are the children of the wicked one. This is not only a physical lineage, but a spiritual one as well. Yahushua told the Pharisees of his day, "Ye are not my sheep." In John 10:26. In Josephus, Wars 2:8:2, Jewish historian Josephus makes it quite clear the Pharisees and Sadducees were not Israelites by birth. For there are three philosophical sects among the Jews. The followers of the first of whom are the Pharisees, of the second the Sadducees, and of the third sect, who pretends to a severer discipline, are called Essenes. These last are Jews, Judah, by birth, and seem to have a greater affection for one another than the other sects have. The real Jews of Jesus's day had absorbed those with contaminated Cainite/Edomite hybrid blood, and therefore these could claim both Abraham and Isaac as their fathers. The wheat and the tares will continually throughout time grow and live together until the end of the age when the angels will separate them. What about the flood? The seed line started over again with Ham and his wife's offspring Canaan. Esau, the serpent seed. Even after the flood had destroyed the original seed of Cain, it picked back up again with Ham's son Canaan, of which Esau then intermingled. There are two different groups of people throughout the Bible and are past, present, and future. Those who are elected to grace while the other is elected for wrath and destruction. These are two specific groups with two specific elections, and only they can hold these elections, no one else is like them. Does it involve every single person in a specific seed line? No. Although it may sound like it means just that, it does not mean that all. That would be like saying all those born into a cursed seed line are doomed for hell and all those born into Yahuwah's chosen seed line are awarded heaven. There are three major aspects that come into play at all times in regarding all things. The choices Yahuwah makes, the choices Lucifer are allowed to make, and the individual choices we make. Esau was born of a good seed line, but he chose to go the way of the wicked. Just as those born of cursed seed lines can choose to go the way of the righteous. Do we choose or are we chosen ahead of time to do exactly what we do? Yahuwah knows the end from the beginning, and he knows those who are his and those who are not, because he knows exactly what is going to happen. And he places his chosen vessels of honor anywhere he wants to, good or bad seed line. And Lucifer will do the same thing, except his vessels are of dishonor. Some say the whole war started with Jacob and Esau, when it actually goes back to Cain, and in these last days it is going to culminate as the seed lines of Cain through the Antichrist will try to destroy and annihilate the seed of Jacob. Remember, it was Esau who married into the cursed Cain race, corrupting his seed and offspring. He wasn't born into a cursed seed line. He turned his back on his good seed line and went the way of the wicked. The seed of Jacob is both the house of Judah and the house of Israel, the 12 tribes. We, America, are part of Israel, folks, as part of Joseph's tribe. Now don't go off into the British Israelism theory, because it is flawed and serves the purposes of the Illuminati, who are trying to claim the British throne goes through King David, when it's been sabotaged over the years, and especially the only ones on the throne there now are imposters. If you look at much of the scattered tribes of Israel today, they include Germany, France, Britain, America, and others, the predominant white races of the world. America itself contains a mixture of all the tribes of Israel here, and many of us are linked to one of the sons. Manasseh is dominate in America, while Britain is Ephraim. Reuben is France, Dan is Greece, etc. The Gentiles relate to the house of Judah and the house of Israel as those who have converted to Yahuwah, for those who do. The entire last day's war puts the Gentiles, other races, in the middle of a war between Satan's people and Yahuwah's people. It is a war to see who will rule from Mt. Zion in Jerusalem, with Satan working through his seed line and Yahuwah working through his, to see who wins. Well, if you have jumped to the back of the book, you know who wins, Yahuwah does. But Satan will be allowed to attempt to rule the world for 42 months before he is utterly demolished by the second coming of Jesus Christ. If you read in Genesis 25:21-23, the war started back in the womb of their mother, Rebekah. And Isaac entreated the Lord for his wife, because she was barren, and the Lord was entreated of him, and Rebekah his wife conceived. And the children struggled together within her, and she said, "If it be so, why am I thus?" And she went to inquire of the Lord. And the Lord said unto her, "Two nations are in thy womb, and two manner of people shall be separated from thy bowels, and the one people shall be stronger than the other people, and the elder shall serve the younger." The twins in her womb were Jacob and Esau. They were already at war with each other then, fighting in the womb, for the Lord had ordained them as two different types of people that would be at war with each other. One would be stronger than the other and the elder would serve the younger. Esau, being born first, would serve Jacob. And if you read the story of Esau and Jacob, Esau selling his birthright to Jacob for a bowl of red, Edom, pottage, lentil beans, it was because the birthright meant nothing to Esau, he despised it. What was the birthright? Bringing forth through his seed line the Redeemer of Adam, Jesus. Esau did not care about it and Jacob was willing to deal and deceive to get it, it meant everything to Jacob. Esau despised his birthright, and Yahuwah despised him. Esau was determined to go his own way and do his own thing and that is what he did. In Genesis 26:34-35 we read how he committed his own seed line to eternal ruin and becoming sons of perdition, even as Judas who betrayed Jesus was. Not only did he give his birthright away to Jacob, he broke the hearts of both Isaac and Rebekah by taking Hittite women as his wives. The Hittites were descendants of Ham, and Ham was one of the sons of Canaan, a cursed seed. Canaan was a son of Ham, and father of all Canaanites including the Hittites. These people were a cursed seed because of what Ham did to his father, Noah. And Ham, the father of Canaan, saw the nakedness of his father, and told his two brethren without. And Noah awoke from his wine, and knew what his younger son had done unto him. And he said, "Cursed be Canaan." Genesis 9:22-24-25. Another event covered up by figurative language. The actual sin was a homosexual act Ham committed on Noah and then laughed about it to his brothers. When Noah awoke from his drunken state, he knew what Ham had done to him and cursed not Ham himself, but his offspring Canaan. The Hittites were the power brokers in the known world then. They controlled most of the economics, money, and merchandising, corporations, and were a very powerful influence. They were worshippers of Satan and had much wealth. When Esau married Hittites, he created high treason against the Most High by adulterating his holy seed with the serpent and cursed seed. He sold his birthright for red pottage, mixes his seed with the serpent seed, and by doing so condemns himself and his entire offspring to the lake of fire, tears. Judas, who betrayed Jesus, was of the serpent seed line as well. He and the Antichrist are both called sons of perdition. Perdition means eternal ruin. All of Esau's descendants were sons of perdition, sons of eternal ruin. Jesus said that Judas was a devil, John 6:70. Sons of perdition are satanic spirits sent to this earth by their father Satan. They were prepared and chosen for destruction through their election before they were even born. The end of the story of the birthright blessings for Jacob and Esau are rather prophetic and an overall picture of the last days. Esau, realizing there was money to be had from being the firstborn included in the blessing, runs off to prepare meat for Isaac, who is going to give him his birthright. Never mind he had promised it to Jacob when he realized there was money involved. He was going to go back on his promise with Jacob. But Rebekah heard what was going on and helped devise a plan to where Jacob could deceive Isaac into believing he was Esau and give him the blessing that Esau had traded Jacob for over a bowl of red pottage. After realizing Jacob had already received Isaac's blessing, Esau begged for a blessing as well. As part of his blessing, Isaac told him, "And by the sword thou shalt live, and shalt serve thy brother, be under his authority, and it shall come to pass thou shalt have dominion, that thou shalt break his yoke from off thy neck. Genesis 27:40. And the war continued between Jacob and Esau. In Genesis 27:41 we read, And Esau hated Jacob, enmity, because of the blessing wherewith his father blessed him, and Esau said in his heart, The days of mourning for my father are at hand, then will I slay my brother Jacob. Jacob was determined to kill Jacob. Jacob had hit Esau where it hurt the most. Jacob got the wealth as part of the birthright he had taken away from Esau. That is probably why Esau married Hittite women, because of his lust for power and wealth. And that seed is the same way today. They control the money around the entire world. They are called Edomites because of Edom, the color red, which is what the bowl of pottage was. Esau was also very red/ruddy and hairy. And to this day it is still their mission to kill Jacob. Esau never succeeded in killing Jacob, but to this day the war continues and the seed of Esau, the Edomites seek to get rid of Jacob's descendants, which are primarily today's Christians and believers in Yahuwah. Jacob's descendants became known as Israelites. Esau's descendants also became known as Reds, which is also seen as the symbolic color of communism. All of the isms were created by the serpent seed, such as socialism, Nazism, humanism, liberalism, etc. And are the backbone of the first beast of Revelation 13, which is the same scarlet-colored beast mentioned in Revelation 17 with 7 heads and 10 horns. Also notice the prophecy that Isaac gave Esau that he would live by the sword and take dominion over the earth. In Revelation 13:10 we read the first beast lives by the sword, will take dominion over the earth, and will die by the sword. Same seed line. It is the New World Order and Zionism that carries the serpent seed line today. It is ruled in the background by the Illuminati families of the serpent seed line. It is Satan's master plan to bring the entire world under a global government through the New World Order so he can rule. Satan's seed will make war against the Lamb seed, believers, Israelites, and Judahites. These shall hate the whore, and shall make her desolate and naked, and shall eat her flesh, and burn her with fire. Revelation 17. Today, the world banking Edomite/Hittite/Canaanite/counterfeit Jews under Satan's rule control the world's economy and preparing the world for global government and the rise of their master, Satan as the Antichrist. In the book of Obadiah there is a prophecy written to the serpent seed line of Esau for the last days. The pride of thine heart hath deceived thee, thou that dwellest in the clefts of the rock, they hide themselves away from public view with their underground bases, whose habitation is high, world authority, political authority, that saith in his heart, Who shall bring me down to the ground, arrogance of their power and strongholds. Verse 3. Though thou exalt thyself as the eagle, Illuminati symbol, and though thou set thy nest among the stars, space stations and planetary bases, thence will I bring thee down, saith the Lord. Verse 4. How are the things of Esau searched out? How are his hidden things sought up? Esau is working through deception and lies and keep their real plans hidden from public view. Verse 6. Shall I not in that day, saith the Lord, even destroy the wise men out of Edom, the learned elders of Zion, which rule behind the scenes, and understanding out of the mount of Esau. Authority, verse 8. And thy mighty men, O Taman, shall be dismayed, to the end that they may be cut off by slaughter, the Lord's judgment on them when he returns. For the violence against thy brother Jacob shall cover thee, war on the saints, and thou shalt be cut off forever, verse 9. But, upon Mount Zion shall be deliverance, and there shall be holiness, and the house of Jacob shall be a fire, and the house of Joseph a flame, and the house of Esau for stubble, and they shall kindle in them, and devour them, and there shall not be any remaining of the house of Esau, for the Lord hath spoken it. Verse 18. And saviors, judges, shall come up on Mount Zion to judge the mount, authority, government, of Esau, and the kingdom shall be the Lord's. Verse 21. Today we have many claiming to be Jews, but are not Jews, and are liars. They are the church of Satan, the synagogue of Satan and are worshippers and followers of him. And what are they doing today? Conquering the world for the Antichrist to rule from Jerusalem. In every nation, in every major event, the Edomite Jews have been behind it. Although the Edomite Jews dominate Israel today, there are a remnant of real bloodline Jews there as well. These are the ones the Lord will protect during the Great Tribulation. Look at America today, who is running the White House? The Edomite Jews and Sons of Cain. Who was arrested for treason during WW2 by Congress for trading with the enemy? Prescott Bush. Who announced the formation of the NWO in America? His son, George Bush, Sr. Who is President of America today? George Bush, Jr. What do the Bushes have in common with Edomite Jews? They are all part of the Serpent seed line of the Illuminati. The Illuminati are at the top of two particular races of people known as the Edomite Jews and the Sons of Cain. And it goes all the way to the top where the Illuminati rule directly beneath the Jesuits. The Jesuits answer directly to the Black Pope. The Black Pope position is the real power position in the Vatican as opposed to the White Pope position. Most think it is the Pope who rules from the Vatican. He may reside there, but the real power in the Vatican is hidden, and it's in the position known as the Black Pope. Black meaning hidden or secret. Today, Hans van Kalvenbach holds the title of the Black Pope. And he is second to none on this earth in establishing Satan's rise to power. He is literally Satan's right-hand man. So what do we have today? The false Jews in Israel being called real Jews. And the real Jews not even knowing who they are. We are being led to believe by the churches today that Satan's chosen are Yahuwah's chosen people. Now are you ready to scream? Orthodox, Reformed, and Messianic Jews disown the Jews running Zionism in Israel today. Not only are they Edomite Jews, but they are also known as the Hazar Jews as well. In 692 AD the Hazar Kingdom was established. These were people that had adopted Judaism as their official religion because of the real Jews that lived among them and proselytized them. From that point on they passed themselves off as real Jews with a right to Palestine as their homeland. They are not lovers of Yahuwah but haters of him. They are of the same ancestry of Esau whom the Lord hated. The offspring of serpents of whom the Lord told them straight out were of their father the devil. It was those of the seed line that instigated his crucifixion. They had infiltrated as the Pharisees in Jesus' era and still dominate the Jewish nation today. And these are the ones the churches believe are the chosen ones of the Lord. If they did 5 minutes of research into Israel today, they would realize their error. Instead, they keep recycling errors and falsehoods week after week, month after month, year after year. We are told by our churches that we must support Israel or the Lord will bring his judgment on this nation when it is the fact that we are supporting them that is bringing his judgment on this nation. Israel today is the prophecy of evil figs of Jeremiah chapters 21 to 24 and the evil fig tree that Yahuwah cursed. He wasn't cursing his own people, but those he hates, the serpent seed lines of Esau and Cain. Jesus said, "Verily I say unto you, if ye have faith, and doubt not, ye shall not only do this which is done to the fig tree, but also if ye shall say unto this mountain, Be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea, it shall be done." Mountain is often symbolic of government or authority. The evil fig tree is the false Jews, the chosen people of Satan. He's telling us to rid the earth of the authority of the Edomites and certainly not to support it. But are we doing? Sending millions of dollars in financial aid and weapons to them yearly. Do you see the irony now? Do you see why judgment is coming to America? If the Edomites are the ones inhabiting Israel today and the ones who call themselves Jews and are not, who and where are the real Jews? Scattered. America is Israel. We are the tribes of Israel scattered all over this country along with the other white nations. The Jews of old were not dark-skinned people. Noah was platinum blonde with blue eyes, David was ruddy with red hair. Ruddy meaning he had flushed cheeks, he could blush. Dark-skinned people don't blush, neither are they born with blonde or red hair. Esau is also described as ruddy and hairy. The Israelites back then were a white race. And who are the white races today? I'm not saying this to be racist, I'm just telling you how it was and is. It was Noah's grandson Canaan, from Ham, who was the father of the darker-skinned races, even the Arab races of today, Sheba and Dedan, etc. were linked to Ham through his son Canaan. If you read in Ezekiel 37:12-14 and 23, the Jews are not in the land of Israel today, they will not being regathered into the land, and will not be until the Lord returns. So the whole facade of Israel returning to their land in the last days is not true. When the Lord returns, he will regather his people from the ends of the earth to the land of Israel, and not until then. So who are the ones there now? The imposters. Haven't you ever wondered why Yahuwah hated Esau? Before he was even born. Why would the Lord make such a statement? Because there are many things that he hates, and Esau was one of them, Mal 1:3. He hated the serpent seed, and he knew what Esau would do. The Lord told me, "Daughter, the mixture of my children with the serpent seed was something I allowed to serve my own purposes. Just as I allowed Satan to defile my garden, I allowed him to defile my people. The way to truth and righteousness is through me. It always has been, and it has not changed. My priests served the people, they did not sanctify them or make them whole. I alone can do that. Today's priests seek to save which they cannot. They lead my people to errors and doctrines of man that cannot save them, nor do they honor or please me. Tell them I am the door. There is no other. Those who want me must walk through my door to me. There is no other way. They worship Baal and call him their god, thinking I am the one they worship. My judgment will come on this carnal and wicked system of religion. It is not of me. Religion profits man, worship and sacrifice profits me. Sacrifice the cares and wants of this world for the cares and wants in me only, and you will never be unsatisfied. I can give you your heart's desires. This world cannot fulfill you. This world is an endless form of greed and want. Never satisfying, it waxes worse and worse, evil and more evil. Yes, Mithra has hidden through the ages behind every god, and he will ultimately rise again to counterfeit me and my word. I will reveal this to you because you seek my face, you seek me, and I will reveal great things to you because you are humble and faithful. I love you, child. Tell them the world had run its course, it's almost time for all the prophecies of old to be fulfilled. Many will never be ready. But stay in me, for I have many things for you to accomplish before the time. Time is short. Daily seek me so I can use you. I have shown you many things in just a short amount of time. I will show you even more. I love you, my child. If you could only see how much you make me smile and know how much I do love you, you would never feel or want for anything again of this world. You're almost there, child. Yet you still have things of me to do in a short time. Be faithful. Be still and hear my voice. I love you, your father, the Most High. Not only do we have the sons of Cain running the corporations, governments, and secret societies that govern most of those, we have the fallen angels still trying to breed with mankind, just as in the days of Noah. Right now there are reptilians in the White House, draconians in the Vatican, and grays in our skies abducting people around the world to use in breeding experiments, and for many, even eating them. Measures our government has agreed to cooperate to with these evil twisted beings to keep these things silent, and has funded disinformation and discredited campaigns, projects, magazines, and organizations to keep the truth from ever being discovered. Which is why, today, the official denial of the existence of UFOs and aliens is, in fact, an official denial. In exchange, they have reaped alien technology through black operations and have carved out of the earth underground joint human and alien bases where this exchange of technology and learning takes place. All funded by the taxpayers. The Bible says they will mingle themselves with the seed of men, and also in Daniel, we are warned of iron mixed with miry clay that will not cling to one another. It is impossible for those created and made in God's image to cling to those who simply want to destroy them and aren't even human. This last kingdom, the prophesied fourth and terrible beast kingdom that will arise in the last days, is an alien nation. For now, they roam earth awaiting their chance to destroy and kill mankind in their envy and rage for mankind being made in God's image. Soon the Lord will take his hand off of America and lift the veil, allowing them to reveal themselves. The presence of aliens is nothing new to planet Earth. They have been here for thousands of years. Their biblical identification is one of being fallen angels who rebelled against God and were kicked out of heaven. Their most notable name is Anunnaki or Anuk. Who were the Anunnaki? They were the watchers, watchmen assigned to Earth to watch over Yahuwah's creation on Earth. They were created by God as perfect angels. These watchers rebelled against God and a mutiny followed as they lusted after human women and abandoned their mission to oversee humans and began to defile the women of the earth by having offspring with them. When men began to increase on earth and daughters were born to them, the divine beings saw how beautiful the daughters of men were and they took wives from among those that pleased them. It was then, and later too, that the Nephilim appeared on earth, when the divine beings cohabited with the daughters of men, who bore them offspring. They were the heroes of old, the men of renown. Genesis, chapter 6, from the Jewish translation of the Torah. According to the Bible. Now it came to pass, when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, and daughters were born to them, that the sons of God, fallen angels, saw the daughters of men, that they were beautiful, and they took wives for themselves of all whom they chose. There were giants, Nephilim, on the earth in those days, and also afterward, when the sons of God came in to the daughters of men and they bore children to them. Those were the mighty men of old, men of renown, Giborim. Genesis 6, 1-4. And the angels who did not keep their proper domain, but left their own habitation, he has reserved in everlasting chains under darkness for the judgment of the great day, having given themselves over to sexual immorality and gone after strange flesh, human, are set forth as an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. Jude 6 and 7. For God did not spare the angels who sinned, but cast them down to hell and delivered them into chains of darkness, to be reserved for judgment, and did not spare the ancient world, but saved Noah, one of eight people, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood on the world of the ungodly. 2 Peter 2, 4-5. The Bible says they will mingle themselves with the seed of men, and also in Daniel, we are warned of iron mixed with miry clay that will not cling to one another. It is impossible for those created and made in God's image to cling to those who simply want to destroy them and aren't even human. This last kingdom, the prophesied fourth and terrible beast kingdom that will arise in the last days, is an alien nation. For now, they roam earth awaiting their chance to destroy and kill mankind in their envy and rage for mankind being made in God's image. Soon the Lord will take his hand off of America and lift the veil, allowing them to reveal themselves. The first watchers who instigated the rebellion were judged accordingly. 200 watcher officers, each in charge of tens of thousands of watcher soldiers, abandoned heaven to mingle with earthly women. Even after the flood, many more rebelled and came to earth following their footsteps. These ones have not been judged yet. The bulk of these fallen angels from both of the earlier rebellions, Lucifer's and the Watchers, have been imprisoned in the hollow planet of Rahab, aka planet Nibiru, which is now returning to earth to help Lucifer overthrow and dominate the earth in the last days. It is in these last days that the Lord will allow them to be released from their prison to fulfill their end-time prophetic role in helping Lucifer subdue the earth. In the Sumerian language, the term Anunnaki meant from heaven who came to earth. The Anunnaki had children that became known as the Nephilim, Rephaim, Emim, Giborim, Philistines, Zamzumim, Anakim, Ivim, and a few other names. The mixing of genes started with Cain's daughters, the women of Canaan who created a DNA defect called giantism. Their children were giants. Some were 30 feet tall. Aliens are not demons. Demons are the spirits of the dead giant hybrid children. These watchers came to earth to be kings, emperors, priests, shaman, tuatangas, manitus, pharaohs, gods, and goddesses. They are the titans, pans, gods, goddesses, and fauns of Greek and Roman mythology. They have supernatural strength, psychic powers, and, oftentimes, have six fingers and six toes. They want us to believe mythology is merely fiction, but it is not. Almost all of the characters are based on real watchers or their hybrid children who played those roles while on Earth. Yes, a lot of it is dressed up to make these characters heroes and gods and goddesses, but you can glean some real truth concerning what was going on back then, minus the garbage they threw in to make them all nice fairy tales. The Anuk are known to be shapeshifters and cannibals. They sacrifice humans, drink blood, levitate objects, astral travel, report the future, practice magical arts, and teach the art of war. They are the masters of astronomy and astrology. They taught mankind abortion so that they could keep certain women beautiful for sexual pleasure. They are the creators of the alien hybrid greys and UFOs of modern times. They can shapeshift into reptilian form and then back into their own. They can be 7 to 9 feet tall on average. They are the armies of the Antichrist. They are the inhabitants of Hollow Nibiru. They will be enforcers of the mark of the beast. And as the Lord has told me, men's hearts will fail with fear when they see these beings on the earth. This earth is going to be cluttered with the tall, the ugly, and the damned. And it's coming sooner than you think. Yahuwah has given me visions in the spirit of the fear and terror which will take place as these giant Anuk return to earth via Nibiru, and just rise up from their underground hideouts, and overthrow America and then the world. At first, they may appear friendly, sincere, and offer to help Earth struggling to survive from wars, natural catastrophes, and famines to deceive the world to invite them to our planet. But the facade of friendliness will not last. They will overthrow our government, replace the law of the land, and dominate this land as they walk through it, putting all people in subjection and fear of them. In America there will be millions of these giants along with the hordes of unhuman-looking aliens of every shape and size and grotesque features that were part of Lucifer's rebellion who lost their angelic looks as part of their judgment. There will be riots and uproars. People will run for their lives and try to fight against them. Sheer panic and the horror over this dominate and massive alien presence will sweep across America. Martial law will be declared, and those who fight against the aliens and the NWO will be terminated. They will be everywhere, wicked and evil. They will force mankind here in America to commit unspeakable sins and atrocities and kill those who refuse without a second thought. They are not coming as our friends. They are complete haters and enemies of mankind who will make Americans their slaves. They will walk through our neighborhoods, towns, and cities in every state and hunt the believers of Yahuwah. They will enforce the mark of the beast. They will help Lucifer take physical control of the earth. They will maim, kill, rape, imprison, and terrify humans everywhere around the globe. As famines escalate because of natural catastrophes and wars, they will eat humans as prey. Yahuwah told me this. Tell them. Do you see the picture developing? The last days are terror. Woe. Woe to those who will seek to harm my little ones. My own I will protect, but woe to the planners of evil and those who plan to destroy the world. I will allow it and then my judgment will come. Many pieces to the puzzle, I will show them to you and reveal my glory through you to the nations. My child, know this that the last days are of suffering and terror. Such terror has never been known before. Those of old, Anuk, will walk and control the earth. They will commit and enforce evil of every kind. And when I return there will be more of them than man left. Woe! Woe! Give them the warnings of terror to come so that they will find peace and strength in me. For I shall lose nothing given to me. Those in my hands are mine. Many will be tested but they are mine. To be refined in the fire and then set gloriously in my light. Tell them, child. Tell them no one can even begin to imagine the horrors that are coming. Your safety and refuge are within me. Tell them. The mixing of fallen angel/alien with human DNA led to a giantism defect in the DNA of the hybrid offspring and an eventual, almost complete, contamination of, not only the human DNA, but the animals as well. Bestiality was common. By the time Yahushuah destroyed the world with a flood because of this contamination and to destroy the hybrid giants and deformed animals, only one family on earth was left with pure human DNA. But even after the flood, the watchers kept revolting, and even more were punished and cast out of heaven, losing their first estate and habitation as they continued to defile women and human DNA. At the time Israel left Egypt, they had to conquer some 20 cities of the Watchers' giant children to reclaim the land of Israel as their own. The Watchers were known as the Nephilim, Anunnaki, or the heroes of old, men of renown as mentioned in Genesis 6:4. Over the years, the human hybrid giant races were destroyed through wars and by their own corruption. The mixing of alien and human DNA did not vanish, it just went underground. Most humans today have contaminated blood in their DNA. Although the human hybrid giantism defect was perfected, the original Anuk are still giants. This hybridization and corruption of the human DNA is still today very much a part of our world, and most hybridization goes undetected. It never stopped from the beginning, they just perfected it, creating their own human/serpent seed lines to mingle with humans. So why is the church silent on UFOs, aliens, abductions, implantations, and forced breedings? These Anunnaki are not our creators. You can read in Enoch chapters 6-15 how they were created beings by Yahuwah in heaven and were assigned to watch over the earth. When they rebelled, they were cast out of heaven, their first estate, although they do still reign in the first and second heavens and inhabit other planets and star systems visiting Earth in UFOs. Many of them live in underground hideouts here in the Earth. In the following years, the theory of evolution will be discredited from the very founder, supporters themselves, and their pawns. You can see this happening even now. They will then promote through government disinformation scientists that mankind was created in a test tube by these Anunnaki and that these Anunnaki are our creators. This is part of the grand delusion and lie at the end of the days. And we are in the end of the days. Instead of preaching the truth, our churches changed the truth to lies and preached the sons of Seth facade, changing the truth of scriptures. These angels were the sons of God who rebelled against him. Our churches also sat back and allowed the book of Enoch to be taken out of the scriptures. What this did was hide the worldwide hybridization and the truth concerning who these aliens are and what they are doing. Why? To keep people in the dark and unprepared for the great lie that is coming. They could not pull it off if everyone already understood who these aliens really are. Many pastors today are following the drumbeat of their training seminaries and not God. They are following man's wisdom, not God's, while religious leaders aren't preparing their congregations for what is coming, and in their own ignorance, they do not even realize they've been deceived themselves because they refused the truth as it is in Yahuwah, and they have blindly accepted only what man has told them to believe or teach. The Lord has told me that in the coming days, these aliens will make their presence more visibly and physically known on earth. They seek only to destroy mankind. Right now they are infiltrating many groups and organizations and claiming through gullible people to be ascended masters who want to help mankind. Do not believe their lies. They speak with forked tongues. They say they want to help save the earth while they plan its overthrow and destruction at the same time. The veil is being lifted. In the near future, even more than there are now, many people will start to proclaim the truths of aliens in our midst. However, not everything they say is true. Their real purpose is to push a dark hidden agenda and to hide the real truth. They will even televise worldwide an interview with an alien who is nothing but Satan himself in alien form. Many of the lies being put out is for this specific reason, to inform the public on the paranormal, occult, UFOs, earth changes, and to herd and brainwash the people into believing that the aliens from outer space are our creators, our forefathers, ascended masters, and enlightened ones. They are creating the foundation for the biggest deception that has ever been perpetrated on mankind. that mankind is a creation of these aliens and that they are our gods, and therefore, there is no real God, the Bible will be wrongfully discredited, and they will proclaim that there are no such things as natural God-given rights. It is about world government and total control over the surviving masses by the elite of the occult secret societies. And that is what these incremental brainwashers will try to do. These aliens are not extraterrestrial, they are terrestrial and subterranean. They live within our earth and parts of our sky. The Bible explicitly tells us that Satan is the prince and the power of the air. It also tells us about demons, hell, hybrids, and the Nephilim and Anunnaki. The Illuminati. The Illuminati are the Nephilim. The Bilderbergers, the main group within the Illuminati also known as the Shadow Government, are the hybrid children of the Nephilim. Mutations of Nephilim DNA over the generations negated the giantism defect, thus allowing them to infiltrate amongst the nations undetected. Many of them infiltrated and intermarried with the surrounding races to contaminate human DNA. At the same time, a select few of the Nephilim were kept aside to keep their DNA pure and uncontaminated from strictly human DNA. To keep it pure, they intermarried between themselves. Just as Yahuwah would have a pure, uncontaminated seed line, so would Lucifer and the Nephilim. The parents of these Nephilim children in charge of keeping certain lines uncontaminated would become their controllers. These controllers, working behind the scenes, today represent these 13 Illuminati bloodlines and rule through 13 super wealthy families. These controllers are aliens and a mere faction of Lucifer's kingdom, controlling world governments through their children. The New World Order is a vast network of organizations and secret societies encompassing government and religion. Like the New Age movement, it is a vast network of loose conglomerates all working together to bring about a common cause. In this instance, the New World Order network is working to bring about one world government where the New Age is bringing about a new world religion of pantheism. In other words, there is a council of aliens who rule the earth through their children whom they have placed to dominate the banking, marketing / corporations and governments. These whom we call the Illuminati, are biblically referred to as Nephilim. This group of hybrid Illuminati children would dominate in every generation through banking and politics. They would dominate money and political power. The Illuminati is the uncontaminated strain of hybrid blood. Uncontaminated from being 100% pure human DNA, that is. The only way to keep it that way is by interbreeding amongst themselves. They consist of 13 family bloodlines that are ruled by their parents, also known as aliens. They are a very secretive group of occult practitioners whose strict bloodlines have been around for thousands and thousands of years. It is not a boys' club but a very well-structured organization consisting of people in the highest offices of government, politics, entertainment, and religion. These people are the super wealthy, who stand above the law. Many of them don't even appear on the lists of the wealthiest people in the world so that they can remain secret. Here are the names of the 13 families also known as the secret government or shadow government. 1. Astor. 2. Bundy. 3. Collins. 4. DuPont. 5. Freeman. 6. Kennedy. 7. Lee, Chinese. 8. Onassis. 9. Rockefeller. 10. Rothschild. 11. Russell. 12. Van Dyne. 13. Merovingian, European royal families. The following families are also interconnected with those above. 1. Reynolds. 2. Disney. 3. Krupp. 4. McDonald. Also, in addition to those four families, there are hundreds of others that are connected more distantly to the main 13 Illuminati bloodlines. Although significant, they are not mentioned here, they are considered less powerful and less pure by the 13 elite bloodlines, although the others make up the bulk of Cain's seed. Those in these particular 13 bloodlines are the top players on the international playground and they are the men who really rule the world from behind the scenes, yes, they are mostly men, with a few exceptions. They are known as the black nobility, the decision makers, the ones who make up the rules for presidents and governments to follow, and they are often held from public scrutiny because they can't stand being scrutinized or questioned. Their power lies in the occult and in the economy. Politicians don't run the world, the bankers do. The Illuminati knows very well since the inception of the ages that money creates power, and through their children they own all the international banks, the oil businesses, the most powerful corporations of industry and trade, and they infiltrate and control world politics. They own most governments and control all elections, ensuring their candidate always gets elected. Free elections are for entertainment purposes only. If you check the family lines of American presidents and their ancestry, you would find they are all related, containing Illuminati bloodlines. So what are the goals of the Illuminati? To create a one-world government and a new world order for Satan to come and rule over. The human aspect, the children of the Nephilim, these Illuminati hybrids are deceived into thinking they will rule the world with Satan, but Satan will have no need for humans when he arrives with millions of his forces to take over the world they established for him. They will find out how expendable they are and no longer needed. The goal of a one-world government has been in the planning throughout the centuries, away from the public's eyes, within the secret societies. All secret societies with secret levels of initiation are owned and controlled by the Illuminati, and Freemasonry is probably the best known. The persons who control the societies and the Illuminati are occultists and Satanists who practice black magic. Their god is Lucifer, the Lightbearer, and by occult practices they manipulate and influence the masses. It doesn't matter if you and I believe in this or not, as long as they do. And they take it very seriously. They don't believe in Satan, but their own definition of Lucifer and what he is to them. From occult technologies given to them by the aliens, they have developed mind control technology and hypnotic suggestion. By taking over the movie industry, the record companies, and by their control of the fine arts, they know how to influence the masses to accept their kind of reality. This makes sense if you look at what kind of entertainment we are enforced to enjoy. It is the Illuminati who created and controls Hollywood, and they influence and condition the masses through ET movies and doomsday films revealing what is, or what is going to be, or what could be. They subtly reveal their plans through Hollywood. The secrets of the Illuminati. One of the first secret societies to merge out of the nations of mankind was the Brotherhood of the Snake, a secret society that refers to Satan, the great serpent, back in the Garden of Eden. The Illuminati consider Satan as the good god, since Satan gave man knowledge and Yahuwah to be evil for trying to suppress the same. It is from this viewpoint that Satanism was developed and is practiced within the secret societies of all ages. The Illuminati have always ruled over the secret societies, under various names throughout the ages. In this day and age, they are known as the Illuminati, or the Enlightened Ones. What they don't want you to know is that they are shape-shifting reptilians. There are two aspects to the Illuminati, the human and the alien. The human aspect that we see, generation from generation, are as children of the Nephilim controlled by their parents, the Anunnaki. It is their hybrid DNA that allows them to shape-shift back and forth between reptile and human forms. An ability that is developed through not only their DNA, but blood drinking and rituals that allows for the presence of reptilian hosts to possess them. The original Brotherhood of the Snake split up into different groups over time as a result of inner fighting and disagreements. As a result, groups such as Freemasonry, Scottish Rite, Rosicrucians, Knights Templars, the Knights of Malta and others were formed, but always led by the Illuminati itself. Public relations campaigns have always been the forefront to keep people away from the real purpose of these societies, such as the Freemasons, who believe their society is one of charity and good works. Rarely is the true purpose revealed unless an initiate is of the highest ranks. Officially, all secret societies are charity organizations, and they will go to great lengths to give the public this impression and use those in the lower ranks as pawns for this purpose. The Illuminati claims to have invented the different religions, sects, and cults so the masses would be busy doing something else instead of looking into what they were actually doing. They put themselves in charge of the churches to enslave people and to spread conflicts between religions. Most wars throughout history have been religious wars to serve the agenda of the Brotherhood. It is the Rothschilds and Rockefellers who head the Illuminati today, working to bring about what they refer to as the Golden Age, the Age of the Antichrist. Secret societies and the Illuminati believe that power is attached to symbols, and thus the symbols of the Illuminati revealing their massive infiltration into every aspect of our society are flagrantly displayed on corporation logos and religious symbols. Simply put, they are everywhere. The world is full of their black magic symbols. The Illuminati believe that the more symbols around, the more magic power to them. The insignia of the Illuminati and the New World Order is the pyramid with the all-seeing eye, which you can study on the back of the US $1 bill. The all-seeing eye is the eye of Horus, which is the eye of Lucifer, and goes back to the Egyptian era. The $1 bill was designed by President Roosevelt's administration. Other common symbols are the pentagram, five-pointed star, the hexagram, six-pointed star, the Star of David, the swastika reversed, the way Hitler used it, and the pyramid in general. Almost every single president of the USA has committed treason when taking office by lying under oath. When a person belongs to a secret society, they take oaths of loyalty foremost to that society or brotherhood. That means that person's first loyalty is always to the brotherhood. This means that if this person has a specific post in society, like being president for example, his first loyalty is to the brotherhood and second to his post as president. So he has in fact double loyalties. Every president swears an oath of loyalty to protect and defend the Constitution of America, yet these societies have an agenda and purpose that betrays and destroys the Constitution. All of these societies are secretly working toward a one-world government, not democracy, no matter how much doublespeak they blab. Neither are they working to protect and defend the freedoms of the people, but they devise ways to enslave them under a fascist rule. Those at the very top of the societies are tested to see whom their loyalty belongs. In Freemasonry, at the lower 30-degree levels, the initiate is asked to spit on the Christian cross or the Bible. If the initiate refuses, he is told he did the right thing, yet never advances from that point on. In fact, most don't even know that Freemasonry goes well beyond the 33rd degree level and all the way up to 360 degrees. If the initiate spits on the cross or Bible, he is advanced and allowed to move on up the chart, where he is then allowed to become more involved with the real purpose of the society, which is black magic and Satanism, and given more knowledge of the secrets of the society. What are the big secrets of these societies and the Bilderberger faction of the Illuminati? That they are in communication with aliens, the real power behind the society, and that their purpose is to bring about a one-world government for these aliens to rule over. They will learn that those in the society and factions are subservient to the alien forces that rule and sit at the top of the chain of command in the ruling hierarchy. They will also learn that one of the instrumental ways to accomplish their goals of a one-world government is through mind control and occult and satanic power used to manipulate the masses. They will use conditioning mediums such as Hollywood and the music industry to control and manipulate the masses into accepting the reality of a new world order and the presence of aliens on Earth. And what do they get in exchange for going along with the goals of the alien Illuminati? If they agree to sell their souls to Lucifer, they will be rewarded with power and wealth. But upon their death, Lucifer gets their soul in return. A high price to pay for temporal success and wealth on Earth. Those who sell their soul to the devil become possessed by demons who will torment them if they should ever go against the goals of the society. The Bilderbergers, Trilateral Commission, and Council of Foreign Relations are all groups within the Illuminati. The United Nations is the world police for the Illuminati. It was founded to be able to step in and take military control over a country or a region which is countering their agenda or rebelling against them. These groups contain political leaders from the President of the United States to leaders of other countries. They include politicians, bankers, media personalities. It is a literal who's who of those in the public domain. Their purpose is a world government by 2012. It is the Bilderberger group that is often referred to as the shadow government. This group contains elected leaders from various countries who betray and sell out their countries to serve the purposes of the Brotherhood and the Illuminati. It is high treason, and this is what our elected officials are doing. The time is coming closer and closer when America will be invaded by thousands, perhaps millions of UFOs and aliens, armed and ready to overthrow our government and population, in collusion with our own government to even do so. Our military will be defenseless against them. They will not come as friendly beings from outer space but as hostile enemies. It is these aliens themselves who have been working through the different factions, secret societies, and world elite to bring about the NWO and global government. They puff up and promise leadership roles, fame, and fortune in the coming global kingdom for those in these societies who cooperate with them and help bring it to pass. But those in these societies and the Brotherhood will learn soon enough why Lucifer Satan is called the father of lies. He will betray and kill them all when he rises to power. Do these people really think he would share his kingdom with anyone? Murder, mayhem, betrayal, double-crossing, and an alien invasion. The time clock for America is ticking. Can you hear it as loudly as I do? The Lord is warning America today. The aliens are coming. The veil is being lifted and the alien nation beast kingdom, prophesied by Daniel and John, will come to pass, enabling the alien beast kingdom to take over the whole world. If you are fence-sitting, it's time to get off the fence. If you are backsliding, it's time to get back with Yahuwah. Time is running out, and unless he protects you, there will be no place to hide. The only safety we have is in him. Many will be hidden by him, and yet many more will suffer martyrdom and testing for his sake. Be prepared for the days coming ahead and stay focused in him. It isn't time to go to sleep,